In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the solid ground is falling out from underneath my feet, between the black skies and my red eyes, I can barely see. And I realize I've been sold out by my friends and my family. And I can feel the rain reminding me. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. It's in the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. And your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When my hopes and dreams are far from me and I'm running out of faith, I see the future I picture slowly fade away. When the tears of pain and heartache are pouring down my face, and I find my peace in Jesus' name. In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. When the test comes in and the doctor says I've only got a few months left, it's like a bitter pill I'm swallowing. I can barely take a breath. And addiction steals my baby girl, and there's nothing I can do. My only hope is to trust in you. So tell me, trust him. I trust you, Lord. It's in the eye of the storm. You remain in control. It's in the middle of the war. You got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. And your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm. And when the storm is raging,
storm is raging,
and my hope is gone,
all hope is gone,
and my flesh is failing,
my flesh is failing,
I'm still holding on,
I'm still holding on.
When the storm is raging,
the storm is raging,
and my hope is gone,
and my hope is gone,
and my flesh is failing,
my flesh is failing,
I'm still holding on,
I'm still holding on.
When the storm is raging,
the storm is raging,
and my hope is gone,
and my hope is gone,
and my flesh is failing,
and my flesh is failing,
still holding on,
I'm still holding on.
In the eye of the storm, you remain in control. And in the middle of the war, you got my soul. You alone are the anchor when my sails are torn. Your love surrounds me in the eye of the storm.
He's always there, amen.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, you've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. You try to feel the same old holes inside, but there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker. You feel lost. He's a way maker. You need freedom, saving. He's a prison-shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know they just ain't right. There's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain. He's a pain taker. You feel lost. He's the way maker. You need freedom or saving. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify, testify. You got pain, he's a pain taker. You feel lost, he's a way maker. You need freedom or saving. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. You need freedom or saving. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker. You need freedom or saving. He's a prison shaking savior. You got chains. He's a chain breaker.
Set us free, amen.
There's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
There is power. There is power in the name of Jesus. And there is power in the name of Jesus. He'll break every chain, break every chain. He'll break every chain.
All sufficient sacrifice, so freely given, such a price, a redemption, heaven's gate, swing wide. And there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. And there's an army rising up. And there's an army rising up. And there's an army rising up. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. And there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Just your voices. There is power in the name of Jesus. So just ask the word of God just to penetrate your hearts this morning as we remember his sacrifice. And I've heard a thousand stories of what
think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper loving the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
And I have seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know just what we need before we ever say a word.
You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. It's love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think. As you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still, as you call me deeper still into love, 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 love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Just you are. You're a good, good Father.
It's who you are. It's who you are.
Then sings my soul, my Savior, bow to thee. And how great thou art, and how great thou art. And then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, and how great thou art.
All right, as people said, amen.
It's 2017. Wow, there went another one. Another year has come and gone, and I remember as a young man my grandmother telling me that as you get older they go faster, And I looked at Grandmother and I said, that's not possible. But Grandma was right. They go faster. If I make it through this year, through 2017, I will have traveled 61 times around this sun, riding this big ball called Earth. 61 times. Now, if you use an automotive analogy, I am a 1956 model with high mileage. I just assumed we didn't use an automotive analogy. Some of those trips have been pretty smooth, and some of those trips have been pretty bumpy. Did any of you ever hear your parents say something like this? We can do this the easy way or the hard way. Raise your hand. Now, the reality is that, what was the circumstance of that phrase? It was more than likely is that you'd already chosen the hard way. And today, there are two stories, two ways illustrated. The easy way and the hard way. I think it would be good to begin 2017 by revealing very intentionally the dangers of doing things the hard way. The book of Deuteronomy, the final of the five books we call, that the Jews call the Torah or the Pentateuch, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. The book of Deuteronomy begins with a statement that illustrates the title of today's sermon, The Hard Way. Let me read to you the couple of verses. Normally, it takes only 11 days to travel from Mount Sinai to Kadesh Barnea, going by way of Mount Seir. Now listen carefully what it just read. Normally, it takes 11 days to go from Mount Sinai to Kadesh Barnea, going by way of Mount Seir. But 40 years after the Israelites left Egypt, on the first day of the 11th month, Moses addressed the people of Israel, telling them everything the Lord had commanded him to say. An 11-day journey took 40 years. That's the hard way. An 11-day journey took 40 years. An 11-day journey to the promised land took 40 years to get there. You want to know what the hard way looks like? That's it. Have you ever gone this way before? The hard way? Maybe that's the road you're on right now. If you'd be honest with yourself today on January 1st, 2017, maybe if you would review the road in which you're traveling, you're doing it the hard way. God had sent Moses to Egypt with a plan to deliver these 2 million people, 2 million children of Israel out of bondage. And his plan, listen carefully, his plan was to walk them straight into the promised land, the land flowing with milk and honey. It didn't have to take 40 years. No, that's the hard way. It could have taken 11 days to go from Mount Sinai, but it took 40 years. We can do this the easy way or the hard way. Now listen carefully to what I'm about to say. I'm not saying the easy way is easy, but it's easy compared to the hard way. And by the way, it is called a wilderness for a reason. Israel chose the hard way. And that brings up my first two points today. The first point is about the time lost. The time lost. It could have taken 11 days. It took 40 years. How much time do you have? How many circles around the sun are you going to get? They lost time. But even more important is the second point. It's about a generation of people that were lost. They lost 40 years, but they also lost an entire generation of people during that 40 years. Time and people. Lost. Why? Time, 40 years. People, huge amount of people didn't make it to the promised land. time and people lost. Why? Because they chose the hard way. There was another way available, but they chose the hard way. I've noticed something. People keep track of time. I've noticed it in church. People keep track of time. Some of you may not know, maybe you've never noticed, that in front of me at the very top up in the sound room, there's a clock. It says 11:01. I never look at that thing, but it's back there. People keep track of time. It's interesting. Why? Because we know that there's a limited amount of it available to us. How many times will you get to go around the sun? That's what time is. Riding this big ball called Earth. How many trips will you get? If I finish this year, it'd be 61. People keep track of time. In fact, I don't even know why you'd care about time if it weren't for people. It is people that make time relevant. Why? Because we understand there's a limited amount. Time and people lost. What if I told you that the element of the hard way, the catastrophe of the hard way, is that you lose time and you lose people? An entire generation of people were lost. They didn't make it to the promised land. They died in the wilderness. The time was 40 years, and it could have and should have been 11 days from Mount Sinai. It was at Mount Sinai that God gave these people the treasure. Did you ever think about it? It was at Mount Sinai that God gave these people the treasure. The treasure, what? His presence. God announced at Mount Sinai when Moses goes up to the mountain that he was going to move into their neighborhood, that God was going to come down and live. They were going to build a tabernacle, and behind the tent in the tabernacle, God was going to come. His Shekinah glory was going to come and dwell behind the veil in the tabernacle, a mobile tent, as they move through the wilderness. And he announced it at Mount Sinai. My presence is coming. I'm going to move into your neighborhood. Before God could move into their camp, behind the veil of the tabernacle, he gave them the conditions that would allow his holiness to dwell among them. He gave them the law. And as he gives them the law, it's like he says, we can do this the easy way or we can do this the hard way. But I'm coming. We can do this the easy way or we can do this the hard way. But I want to tell you, I'm coming. I'm going to come live among you. Time and people. God was and is in charge of both. And God has chosen exactly the right time to deliver these people out of Egyptian bondage and move them to the promised land. There's nothing coincidental about it. He has chosen the exact time and the exact people that he's going to move into the promised land. In fact, God has announced the time and the people to the first Israelite named Abraham. Before there was even the first Israel, Abraham's grandson named Jacob. In fact, he's going to announce to Abraham 500 years in advance the time and the people that will enter the promised land. You know what's going to happen in 500 years? He does. Before I read it, can I say this? Abraham chose the easy way. He believed God. While you're in the wilderness, you need to come to a strict conclusion. There's a hard way and there's an easy way. And I'm going to give you the answer to the test. The easy way is you believe God. Abraham believed God. That's the easy way, especially when you find yourself in the wilderness. I didn't say it was easy to believe God. You did not hear me say that. It is not easy to believe God. In fact, it's unnatural many times to believe God. It's against my nature sometimes to believe God. But I'm going to tell you, it's the easy way compared to the hard way because the hard way doesn't go to the promised land. You die in the wilderness. I said believing God is the easy way. Again, 500 years before Moses and the wilderness journey, this is what happens. Genesis chapter 15. And as I read it, let me say something. I wrote this sermon a long time ago. Couldn't find a time or place to use it, so I kind of sat on it. And especially when you read what's happened in the United Nations and this issue of Israel the week before Christmas. Now, in light of that, this is exactly the right time. Genesis chapter 15. And Abram believed the Lord. That's the easy way. And Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord counted him as righteous because of his faith. Then the Lord said to him, to Abram, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans. To do what? Why did he bring him out of Ur of the Chaldeans? To give you this land as your possession. What land? The promised land, Israel. But Abram replied, O sovereign Lord, how can I be sure that I will actually possess it? The Lord told him, bring me a 3-year-old heifer and a 3-year-old female goat and a 3-year-old ram, a turtle dove and a young pigeon. So Abram presented all these to him and killed them. Then he cut each animal down the middle and he laid the halves side by side. He did not, however, cut the birds in half. Some vultures swooped down to eat the carcasses, but Abram chased them away. As the sun was going down, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a terrifying darkness came down over him. Then the Lord said to Abram, you can be sure. Now, I'm not going to go over those words lightly. A blood covenant is about to take place between God and man. A blood covenant. He has severed these animals in half. There's blood everywhere. And a darkness is descending, and God is descending. And then he says what? You can be sure that your descendants, he doesn't have any descendants. He doesn't even have any kids. You can be sure that your descendants will be strangers in a foreign land, a reference to future bondage in Egypt. You can be sure that your descendants will be strangers in a foreign land where they will be oppressed as slaves for 400 years. But I will punish the nation that enslaves them, and at the end they will come away with great wealth. As for you, Abram, you will die in peace and be buried at a ripe old age. And after 4 generations, your descendants will return here to this land. Where are they having this conversation? They're in the promised land. But you're going to go to Egypt, and you're going to be in Egypt for 400 years, and then after 4 generations, you're going to come back to this land. Why? For the sins of the Amorites do not yet warrant their destruction. Please don't miss that last sentence. In the middle of this covenant, in the middle of these animals being cut in half, in the middle of the covenant of God, promise of God about the land that he's given to Abram and his descendants, there's some people living in that land. There's some people living in the promised land. They're the Amorites. And he says, the sin of the Amorites do not yet warrant their destruction. We can do this the easy way or the hard way. Do what? Everybody listen. God's got a plan. He's not real interested in your plan or my plan. He's already got a plan. He didn't call Abraham in to hear what Abraham ought to do. He called Abraham in to tell him what he was going to do. And listen, Abraham believed him. That's the easy way to get to the promised land. Abraham believed God, and that belief in God made him right with God. That's the easy way. I didn't say it was easy to believe God. I said it's easy in comparison to the hard way, because the hard way leaves you in the wilderness outside the promised land. So what is this plan of God? Let me repeat it, verse 7. The Lord told Abram, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land as your possession. Was this Abraham's idea? Or was this God's idea? Who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans? How would you like to be from Ur? Where are you from? Ur? What? Ur? How would you even explain it? God says, I am the God who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans. Why? I brought you out for a specific calling, purpose. I'm going to give you and your descendants this land. Abraham would say, I don't have any descendants. Whose plan is it? Was it Moses' idea to leave Egypt and head to the land of promise, or was it God's idea? You see, we can do this the easy way or we can do this the hard way. The easy way is to make sure that it's not your idea. You ever think it's a coincidence that in Christianity there's a fundamental event? Jesus says that if you want to be my disciple, you must deny yourself, take up a cross to follow me, which means your ideas no longer are relevant. Your dreams, your hopes, your aspirations, until they come under the blood of Christ, until they are transformed into the plan of God, they have no purpose. You want to do things your way? It's the hard way. You want to do things His way? It's the easy way. I didn't say it's easy to follow Him. I said it's easy in comparison to the hard way. You see, God picked Abraham, and God picked the land that He was going to give Abraham. Abraham didn't pick this plan. Abraham didn't pick this land. What did Abraham do? God picked Abraham. God picked the land. So what did Abraham do? Come on. It's really important. What did Abraham do? He believed Him. He believed Him. That's the easy way. God then enters into a blood covenant with Abraham, a covenant with great promises, with great details about the future. God tells Abraham that his children will be slaves in a foreign land for 400 years before Abraham has any children. And guess what? Abraham believed God. That's the easy way. God tells Abraham that He will deliver them out of that Egyptian bondage, and He will guide them and deliver them to the promised land at the end of the 400 years. And guess what? Abraham believed Him. That's the easy way. God tells Abraham that these slaves will not only be set free after 400 years of Egyptian bondage, but when they are set free, God will do something to the minds of the Egyptians, and they will hand all of their wealth. By the way, they were the richest nation on earth in that time. They will transfer all their wealth to these slaves that are now leaving town. Abraham believed Him. That's the easy way. It's not Abraham's plan. It's God's plan. He's looking for somebody who will believe His plan. God even tells Abraham, this is the part that really gets me. God even tells Abraham who's going to be living in the promised land 500 years in the future. God even tells Abraham who will be there when Moses arrives 500 years in the future. Abraham believed Him. That's the easy way. Let me read it to you again. Verse 13. Then the Lord said to Abram, you can be sure that your descendants will be strangers in a foreign land, where they will be oppressed as slaves for 400 years. But I will punish the nations that enslaves them, the nation that enslaves them, and at the end, they will come away with great wealth. As for you, Abram, you will die in peace and be buried at a ripe old age. And after four generations, your descendants will return here to Israel, to this land, for the sins of the Amorites do not yet warrant their destruction. Abram, you will die in peace at a ripe old age. Abraham believed God, and that's the easy way to get to the promised land. Just believe Him. But what about the Amorites? Why are the Amorites written into the story 500 years in the future? What about the Amorites? They were devoted to destruction. Listen carefully. They were devoted to destruction, but not yet. God saw their future. He is seeing Abraham's future, but He's also seeing the future of the Amorites. They're devoted to destruction, but not yet. Four more generations, and then they'll be devoted to destruction, time and people. God has both of them well under control, time and people. Maybe this is where I ought to add the third item today, because that's really what the story of man's all about. Listen carefully, time, people, and a promised land. That's the story of man. Time, you only get so much. People, well, that's us, and a promised land. That's what this whole story is about. Listen very carefully to what I'm about to say. Listen carefully. It didn't have to take 40 years to go from Mount Sinai to the promised land in the time of Moses. Let me say it again. It did not have to take 40 years to go from Mount Sinai, where God's presence came into the camp of Israel. It didn't have to take 40 years from there to the promised land, but it did have to take 400 years of bondage in Egypt to go to Mount Sinai. Why? God prophesied the one. It'll be 400 years of Egyptian bondage. Man chose the other. 40 years. It should have taken 11 days. That's the hard way. We can do this the easy way. We can do this the hard way. Can I just push pause in the story of Abraham and Moses and the promised land and ask you a question today? What are your plans for 2017? You going to do this the easy way? You going to do this the hard way? You going to believe God? Or do you have your own plan? You got your own plan? That's the hard way. There are some people no longer with us today that were here a year ago. You know that? I've done several funerals in this church in 2016. There are some people who aren't riding on the earth anymore around the sun. They've gotten off. I don't know that they started January 1st, 2016 expecting they wouldn't make it to the end. But they didn't make it to the end. A time, a people, and a promised land. It's the story of man. There's some people who aren't here. And I ask you a question. Do you want to do 2017 your way? Or you want to do 2017 God's way? One is the easy way and the other is the hard way. You see, here's the deal. God was going to give Abraham's children land that was occupied by another group of people. Please listen, especially in light of modern things going on in the United Nations and Israel and the U.S. government. As this story opens, God is announcing He's going to give Abraham's children a land that was occupied by another group of people. And did I mention the whole earth belongs to Him? Maybe you think that's unfair to the people who live there. Then you need to understand who owns the land and who owns everything. In Psalms chapter 24, it's revealed. And by the way, the only way I can say it's revealed is I believe that what I hold in my hand is the only physical source of absolute truth on this planet. I believe this is literally and physically God's Word. So when I read Psalms 24, here's what I read. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to Him. For He laid the earth's foundations on the seas and He built it on the ocean's depths. Do you believe that? That's the easy way. Maybe you can say, I don't really believe that. Maybe you think the United Nations ought to decide who lives where, when, and how. That'd be the hard way. You see, God saw the evil of the Amorites and He was planning to destroy them. Maybe you're offended by that concept. Maybe you think that's unfair or unjust that God saw in the future, 500 years in the future, the sin of the Amorites and devoted them to destruction, and He's going to give their land to a bunch of Egyptian slaves. What if it's all His anyway? Can't He give it to whoever He wants to? Just believe Him. You see, he knew that the time was coming that their destruction would be warranted. A time, a people, and a promised land. Do you believe God has a plan for all three? I hope so, because that's the easy way. We can do this the easy way or the hard way. And I'll say it again. I didn't say the easy way is easy. I just said it's easy in comparison to the hard way, because the hard way leaves you in the wilderness wandering in circles. So let's continue in the story of God and Abraham and the covenant. Verse 17. After the sun went down and darkness fell, Abram saw a smoking firepot and a flaming torch pass between the halves, the bloody halves of the carcasses. So the Lord made a covenant with Abram that day and said, I have given you this land. I have given this land to your descendants. God, it's His land, right? I have given this land to your descendants all the way from the border of Egypt to the great Euphrates River, the land now occupied by the Kenites, Kenizzites, Kadmonites, Hittites, Perizzites, Raphaites, Amorites, Canaanites, Girgashites, and Jebusites, and any other ites they found running around the area. The Lord made a covenant with Abram that day. It was decided that day, and it was declared that day. What? That God is going to give that piece of land to the people of Israel. And you know what Abraham did? He did a crazy thing. He believed God. And it was credited to him as righteousness. And that's the easy way. I didn't say it was easy. I'm just saying it's easy compared to the hard way. 500 years later. Now, I want to go back to the book of Deuteronomy. It's like moving 500 years in the future from this blood covenant between Abraham and God. 500 years, and let me give you the context. 500 years after Abraham has Isaac, after Joseph goes to Egypt, after 400 years of Egyptian bondage that led to a burning bush and a deliverer named Moses, after the parting of the Red Sea, and after Mount Sinai and the fire of God and the Ten Commandments, and after God moving into the tabernacle, the Shekinah glory coming and dwelling in the neighborhood of Israel, and after the 40 years of wilderness wanderings that should have taken 11 days. After all of that, as Deuteronomy opens, these people, including Moses, are still on the east side of the Jordan River. Now, if you don't know geography, you don't really understand what I just said. After all of that story that I just revealed that encapsulates 500 years of the history of mankind, 40 years of wilderness wandering, Moses and 2 million estimated people still find themselves on the east side of the Jordan River. Can I just say, that's not in the promised land. You'd have to go over the Jordan River to get in the promised land, on the west side. So when you hear the newspaper talk about the west bank of the Jordan River, that's inside the promised land, geographically, as we know the promise of God. But in this story, as I'm about to read, Deuteronomy chapter 1, again, they're on the east side of the Jordan River. They haven't crossed over. They've been walking in circles for 40 years. Verse 1. These are the words that Moses spoke to all the people of Israel while they were in the wilderness east of the Jordan River. They were camped in the Jordan Valley near Supth, between Paran on one side and Tophel, Laban, Hazeroth, and Dizahabah on the other. Normally it takes 11 days to travel from Mount Sinai to Kadesh Barnea, going by way of Mount Seir. But 40 years, it normally just takes 11 days, but 40 years after the Israelites left Egypt, on the day of the 11th month, on the first day of the 11th month, Moses addressed the people of Israel, telling them everything the Lord had commanded him to say. This took place, are you ready for this? This took place after he had defeated King Sihon of the Amorites. Do you get it? Who had ruled in Heshbon, and King Og of Bashan, who had ruled in Ashtaroth and Edrei. The sin of the Amorites had reached its conclusion. They are about to enter the promised land in this scene, but they did it the hard way. A time, a people, and a promised land. The story of man traveling on earth around the sun. When Israel left Egypt some 40 years earlier, do you know how many were in the group? Men, fighting age, 20 years and up. Do you know how many? I'm amazed at the detail in this book. If you'll ever actually study it, I am amazed at the detail. 40 years before what I just read, when they left Egypt, the Bible says there were 603,550 men of fighting age among them. You know how I know that? It's in the book of Numbers. You know why they call Numbers Numbers? Because there's numbers in it. That's deep, isn't it? Let me read to you Numbers 2:32. In summary, the troops of Israel, listed by their families. Now, this is Numbers chapter 2. They're just leaving Egypt. How many are there? 603,550. That's adult men, age 20 and up, fighting age men. 603,550. So let me ask you a question. How many of those original men made it to the promised land? Two. That's the hard way. Two. Do you think everybody goes to the promised land? Two made it. That's the hard way. A time, a people, and a promised land. It's the story of man about people riding on earth, going around the sun. That generation of men died in the wilderness during those 40 years of wandering. You know why? You know why they died? Because they refused to believe God. That's the hard way. 40 years later, again, the detail blows me away. 40 years later, after that original generation of men had died, do you know how many men of fighting age now stand on the east side of the Jordan River? You know the Bible tells us? I read to you the first number from Numbers chapter 2, but if you go to Numbers chapter 26, you'll find how many there are now standing after all that generation died off. Now, 40 years later, how many men are there? Put it up on the screen. In summary, the registered troops of all Israel now are 601,730. In 40 years in the wilderness, the boys grew up into men. Babies were born. And the number of men entering the promised land is almost the same as it was the first time. In fact, you know the mathematical difference between 40 years? There's only 1,820 less now than there was the first time they should have entered. God's going to do what God's going to do. That's the easy way. God's going to do what God's going to do. The only question is whether or not you want to do it the easy way or the hard way. Time. God's got plenty of it. We're the ones running out. How many more trips around the sun do you think you're going to get? I'm not sure. How many? People. Are you one of His? This is the story of man. Time, people, and a promised land. People, are you one of His? Can I tell you, the Amorites were not. They were devoted to destruction. Are you one of His? Are you one of His? 603,548 of that first group of men out of Egypt were not. Two were. It's the story of man. You can do this the easy way, you can do this the hard way. This idea that everybody makes it to the promised land is a lie. It's a lie. Everybody doesn't make it to the promised land. People get mad at me for bringing up the truth. Everybody's not going to the promised land. You've been invited to the promised land. His glory has made a way to the promised land. But you'd have to believe Him. It's called faith. A promised land. Two men entered the promised land from that first group of 603,550. That's not very good odds. You know what? But do you know, forget the odds. Do you know why two made it? They believed God. There you go. They believed God. That's the easy way. I didn't say it's easy to believe God. That's not what I said. But it's easy in comparison to the hard way. In fact, the unbelievers around Joshua and Caleb cost Joshua and Caleb 40 years of their life in the wilderness. I wonder if they were bitter. I believe I would be. There were two guys that believed God, and because the rest of them didn't believe God, that entire generation of them were lost in the wilderness, walking in circles until they died. It cost Joshua and Caleb much of their youth. 40 years lost. Did you ever wonder why they call the Promised Land the Promised Land? You ever stop and wonder? Whose plan is this anyway? Is it Abraham's plan? Is it Moses' plan? Is it Joshua, Caleb? Or is it just God's plan? God made a covenant with Abraham, and that covenant was extended to all who would believe in him. I got some good news today. It doesn't matter whether you're a Jew or whether you're a Gentile. You can believe, and you can enter into this covenant that God began with a man named Abraham. In fact, believing the words of God made a person a part and a recipient of the promises of God that he made to Abraham. A time, a people, and a promised land. You can do it the easy way, you can do it the hard way. But God has already announced that it's going to happen. So I'll ask you this, all of that to ask this. What time, what people, what promised land? We've got to bring it to today. What time, what people, what promised land? We didn't just come in here today to talk about ancient history. What time, what people, and what promised land? Do you know how the New Testament opens? And by the way, do you know what the word testament means? Covenant. You know how the New Covenant book of Matthew opens? Let me read the first verse. This is the record of the ancestors of Jesus. The ancestors of Jesus. The Messiah. He is a descendant of David and of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Isaac was the father of Jacob. Jacob was the father of Judah and his brothers. This is how the New Testament begins. Why? Why? Why does the New Covenant begin by announcing Jesus came from David and Abraham? Why? To connect the covenants together into one. The promise of Abraham is fulfilled through Christ. Now, if you just go down a few verses, verse 17, it says this: all those listed above include 14 generations from Abraham to David, 14 from David to the Babylonian exile, and 14 generations from the Babylonian exile to the Messiah. 14, 14, 14. Does that sound random to you, out of control to you? Or does that sound like a plan? That somebody's got this plan. I see this story where God calls this man Abraham and he gives him details of a land, details of a plan. 500 years in advance, he says, there's going to be people living there, but we're going to move those out. They're devoted to destruction. We'll move you in. And in the meantime, you're going to be slaves in Egypt. And by the way, when you get ready to leave Egypt, all the wealth of Egypt will be handed to you, but you'll die at a ripe old age. Is this a plan? Whose plan? Time for what? 2 Corinthians 6:12. Here's where it applies to this room. Some of you read this during communion time. I hope you read it and you believed it. Because here's what it says to the church in Corinth in the church age. As God's partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. Listen carefully. You know what? All those Israelites in Egypt, they were offered a marvelous gift through the deliverer named Moses. There's a promised land, and we're going to break the chains of your bondage and escort you across the wilderness into the promised land. And you know what? Two of them made it. And what's Paul saying to the church? What's he saying to you and to me? Here it is. Let me read it again. As God's partners, I'm going to personalize it. I today beg you. I beg you, do not accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. He's invited you and I to the promised land. He's going to take off our chains, our bondage. He's going to escort us personally through the inhabitation of the Holy Spirit across the wilderness and into the land flowing with milk and honey. One more time, as God's partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. For God says, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is when? Say that loud. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. When should you believe? Now. Today. You can do this the easy way, you can do this the hard way. I didn't say the easy way was easy. I just said it's easy in comparison to the hard way. A time and a people. What people? I thought this was about Abraham and God's covenant, blood covenant with Abraham. No. In the church age, it's connected. Galatians 3:6, in the same way. He's writing to a Gentile church, and he says, in the same way, Abraham believed God, and God counted him as righteous because of his faith. The real children of Abraham then are those who put their faith in God. What's more, the scriptures look forward to this time when God would declare to the Gentiles to be righteous because of their faith. God was looking forward to the day that he would declare Gentiles righteous. Why? Because we believe him. God proclaimed this good news to Abraham long ago when he said, all nations will be blessed through you. So all who put their faith in Christ share the same blessing Abraham received because of his faith. God made a covenant with Abraham. He sealed it with blood, and then God sent his only son, Jesus, to the earth. And he offered a covenant of blood with all who believed. Do you believe him? It's a Thursday night. They're in Jerusalem. Jesus will die on Friday morning. They will put nails in his hands and feet. They will hold him up for the world to see. But before they kill him, he says this. He does this. Luke 22. After supper, he took another cup of wine and he said, this cup is a new covenant. Now, I want you to hold in your mind what God did to Abraham. There are these animals and they are cut in two and there's blood everywhere. And God is going to have his presence pass between the carcasses and seal a blood covenant with a man named Abraham about a people, a time, and a promised land. Now, all these years later, Jesus on a Thursday night says, what? This cup is a new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. Abraham believed God, and that belief in the covenant promises, sealed in blood, made him right with God, made him at peace with God and at peace in his own soul. Now it's our time. I tell you, church, this is our time to believe God, to receive the promises of God sealed through the blood of Christ. This is how you and I are made right with God. This is how you and I will enter the promised land. What promised land? Are we moving to Israel? When I use the word promised land, what's in your mind? Are we moving to Israel? Are we going to Canaan? We're going to get on an airplane and go somewhere? What promised land? The first promised land is what God did in Mount Sinai. He moved into their neighborhood. Actually, before he moved into their neighborhood, he comes to a man named Moses. He's in this wilderness, and a bush starts burning. And what does the burning bush tell Moses to do? Take off your shoes because you're standing on holy ground. What made the ground holy? A bush? No. God was coming to make a piece of property holy. Moses, you're standing. Is it about the land? No, it's about who's on the land. So when God came to that wilderness became holy. And Moses, you need to adjust yourself to the holiness that has now approached you. Take your shoes off. Fast forward to the mountain of God. Moses receives the law of God. And what happens? God tells Moses, I am going to come and dwell behind a curtain in a mobile tent. My glory is going to make that place holy. It was called the most holy place, the holy of holies. It's holy ground. You can't just walk in there. Take off your shoes. It's holy ground. Today, the Spirit of Christ wants to move inside your tabernacle. the Spirit of God. You know what tabernacle is? It's a fancy word for tent. Today, I'm telling you, church, the truth. The Spirit of God wants to move inside your tent. And that Spirit wants to escort you across the wilderness into the promised land. You won't make it into the promised land unless He's in you. I'm telling you the easy way. Believe Him. The Spirit of God wants to come inside your tabernacle and make you holy ground. Not because I'm holy. I can't make me holy ground. But when He comes into me, it becomes holy ground. Today, the Spirit of Christ wants to travel with you through the wilderness on way to the promised land into His eternal presence. You can do this the easy way or you can do it the hard way, but I'm going to tell you, Jesus is the only way you're going to make it to the promised land. One day, we're all going to cross over Jordan. One way or the other, we're going to cross over Jordan. If you want to ignore it, you're still going to cross over. You want to pretend like it'll happen to everybody but you? You're still going to cross over. Eat broccoli and yogurt and all that yucky stuff? You're still going to cross over Jordan. You can do it the easy way. You can do it the hard way. Abraham believed God. Joshua, Caleb, they believed God. Moses believed God. And here's the last point. Listen. But Moses didn't go into the promised land. Joshua and Caleb were the two out of that first group that got to go in, but Moses didn't go into the promised land. Really? Are you sure? Are you sure? You are right that God was angry with Moses and didn't allow him to cross the River Jordan along with Joshua and Caleb and those 601,730 men with their families. You'd be right. Today I began with the first chapter of Deuteronomy, and I will close with the last chapter of Deuteronomy. Let me read it to you. Did Moses cross the River Jordan? Did he cross from the east side to the west side? Did he enter the promised land? Deuteronomy 34. Then Moses went up on Mount Nebo from the plains of Moab and climbed to Pisgah's peak, which is across from Jericho. And the Lord showed him the whole land, from Gilead as far as Dan, all the land of Naphtali, the land of Ephraim and Manasseh, all the land of Judah, extending all the way to the Mediterranean Sea. By the way, if you know geography, that would be the entire width of what we know today, the nation of Israel. The Negev, the Jordan Valley, the Jericho, with Jericho, the city of palms as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to Moses, "This is the land I promised." Where's Moses? He's standing on the opposite side of the river. He's not in the promised land. He's on Mount Pisgah, on the other side, on the east side, outside the promised land. And then God says, "This is the land I promised on oath to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when I said, 'I will give it to your descendants.' I have now allowed you to see it with your own eyes, but you will not enter the land." So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, just as the Lord had said. The Lord buried him in a valley near Beth Peor in Moab, but to this day no one knows the exact place. Moses was 120 years old when he died, yet his eyesight was clear and he was as strong as ever. The people of Israel mourned for Moses on the plains of Moab for 30 days until the customary period of mourning was over. Now Joshua, son of Nun, was full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands on him. So the people of Israel obeyed him, doing just as the Lord had commanded Moses. There has never been another prophet in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. The Lord sent him to perform all the miraculous signs and wonders in the land of Egypt against Pharaoh and all his servants and his entire land. With mighty power, Moses performed terrifying acts in the sight of all Israel. Now I'm going to make a confession to you. I usually weep when I read that last chapter. When I think of all this man of God did, and he stands on top of that hill watching Joshua and Caleb lead across these 2 million people into the promised land, and he doesn't get to go, it breaks my heart. But I usually only weep for a moment because I know the rest of the story. Some 1,500 years later, Jesus was born. And do you know where Jesus was born? In Bethlehem. Bethlehem is on the west side of the Jordan River. It's in the Promised Land. Jesus is born 1,500 years later in the Promised Land. Not on the outside of the Promised Land, but on the inside of the Promised Land. Some of you would say, so what's that got to do with Moses? Everything. Jesus takes his closest disciples to a private mountain in order to reveal his heavenly glory to them. And guess who is there with Jesus inside the Promised Land? Guess who's there? Moses. Matthew 17. 6 days later, Jesus took Peter and his two brothers, James and John. He led them up a high mountain to be alone. As the men watched, Jesus' appearance was transformed so that his face shone like the sun. His clothes became as white as light. And suddenly, Moses and Elijah appeared and began talking with Jesus. It's 1,500 years before that he was on Mount Pisgah, and now he's standing and talking to Jesus inside the Promised Land. You can do 2017 the easy way, or you can do it the hard way. But I can tell you there's only one way to get into the Promised Land. His name's Jesus. Would you say the name out loud with me? Jesus. Say it out loud. Jesus. You can do this the easy way or the hard way, but there's only one way to get in the Promised Land. It is through the blood of Christ. Believe Him. It's called faith. It's what makes you right with God. It's what makes you at peace with God. In fact, the beautiful thing is it makes you at peace with your own soul. Jesus. Faith is what brings the Spirit of Christ inside of your tabernacle while you travel through this current and difficult wilderness life. And it is His presence, His power, that will deliver us all the way across the Jordan River into the real Promised Land of His presence. It's not easy. It's not easy. It wasn't easy for Moses. But Moses made it to the Promised Land, and he stands in the presence of Jesus Christ right now. It's not easy. It wasn't easy for Abraham, and it won't be easy for you. But Abraham, I can tell you, he made it to the Promised Land. You know how I know? In fact, Jesus tells a parable in the New Testament, and he announces that Abraham is where? Well, let me read it to you. Jesus' parable in Luke 16. He says this, "Finally, the poor man died," the rich man and Lazarus story. "The poor man died and was carried by the angels to be with whom?" Abraham. Where do you think the angels are heading? To the real Promised Land. He's carried into the presence of Abraham. "The rich man also died and he was buried. And his soul went to the place of the dead." I'm going to tell you, everybody doesn't go to the Promised Land. This man dies and his soul is carried to the place of the dead. They're in torment in the place of the dead. Not unconscious. Not without thought. He's in torment in the place of the dead. Why? Because he chose the hard way. He refused to believe God. There in torment, who did he see? He saw Abraham in the far distance with Lazarus at his side. The rich man shouted, "Father Abraham, have pity, have some pity. Send Lazarus over here to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I am in anguish in these flames." I'm going to tell you the truth. Most people aren't going to make it to the Promised Land. I find saying that out loud makes people mad at me. But I am bound by the Word of God to tell you the truth. Most people aren't going to make it to the Promised Land. Why? Because it's not easy, and it's not easy because it's not natural. It's against our nature to walk by faith. It's against our nature to release our way into His hands and choose His way. It wasn't easy for Moses, it wasn't easy for Joshua or Caleb, but I can tell you, they all made it to the Promised Land. A time, it's our time to believe Him and share the good news with others. A people, We must walk by faith and not by fear, church. We are the blood-bought children of the Most High God. Somebody say hallelujah. We are the blood-bought children of the Most High God. We have been, our chains have been broken, not by Moses, but by Jesus Christ. He moves inside of us and walks us through the wilderness. He will get you into the promised land, but you must believe him. Heaven's coming. I close with an illustration. There was an international flight flying over the ocean, leaving the United States. In the middle of that flight, there's a terrible storm, and lightning strikes the airplane. The lightning strike is so severe that it destroys all their navigation, all their electronics, everything goes out. The engines are running, but they have no navigation, no compass, no nothing. They don't know where they are, and they don't know where they're going. All navigation's gone. So the pilot gets on the radio to address the passengers, and he says, I've got some good news and I've got some bad news. The bad news is we've been struck by lightning and I have no navigation systems. The engines are running, but I don't know where we are and I don't know where we're going. We're flying blind. Some guy said, well, what's the good news? He said, we're making good time. And we laugh at that story, and I laugh at that story too, but the reality is this. Some of you, if you'd be honest with yourself, you are in the wilderness and you're walking in circles and you think you're making good time, but you don't know where you're going. You have no clue where you're going. You're just walking in circles through the wilderness. It should have taken 11 days. It took them 40 years. I'll ask Chad to come out for the invitation. It should have taken 11 days to go from Mount Sinai to the Promised Land. You know why they didn't make it in 11 days? Their navigation was off. They would not follow the one that knew the way. Are you? Do you think you can get the Promised Land on your own? You'll die in the wilderness. The invitation has already been sent. Jesus has already done all that needs to be done in your Egypt to set you free. He's already promised the inhabitation of the Holy Spirit inside your tabernacle to lead you to the Promised Land. That's the easy way. Believe him. Receive him. He'll escort you all the way to the end. But if you choose your way, you've chosen the hard way, and you'll wander until you die in the wilderness unless you let him in. Maybe today's that day for you. The invitation of Christ is now open. Let's stand.
And our Father everlasting, Thee our created one, God Almighty, through Your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three and one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. The Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, Cause our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. And I believe in you. And I believe you rose again. And I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in life eternal. I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
One last question. If you're like me, you read the stories of those 600 and something thousand guys and you wonder, how in the world could you not believe? You saw all the miracles. You saw the pillar of fire, the pillar of cloud. You saw the parting of the Red Sea. You saw all that stuff, and yet you refused to believe and follow. So I ask you a question. Can you not see what's going on around us? Can you not see God and His glory? Can you not see the evidence of God? He has not left us without a witness. The Word of God. We are now, right now, in this generation, watching Bible prophecy being fulfilled. And many in the church still don't see it. Father, I pray that you'd open our eyes today. I ask in Jesus' name, open our eyes. Open our ears. Let us hear what the Spirit's saying to the churches. Open our minds, our hearts, so that we might receive, believe, and obey you. Follow you into the promised land. Father, I pray that not only will you open our eyes, our ears, our hearts, but you would give us a passion for the lost, those who are still left in Egypt. Those who are just walking circles in the wilderness, thinking that everybody makes it across the River Jordan into the promised land, when your word has declared that they will not. Make your church the light of the world again. Make your church the salt of the earth again. And Father, make your church ready for the day that you come to take her. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for being here.